Tomorrow morning, if you wake up and the sun does not appear, I will be here. If in the dark we lose sight of love, hold my hand and have no fear, 'cause I will be here. I will be here when you feel like being quiet, when you need to speak your mind, I will listen, and I will be here when the laughter turns to crying, through the winning and losing and trying, we'll be together, 'cause I will be here. Tomorrow morning, if you wake up and the future is unclear, I will be here. As your seasons are made for change, our lifetimes are made for years, so I will be here, and you can cry on my shoulder, when the mirror tells us we're older, I will hold you, and I will be here, to watch you grow in beauty, and tell you all the things you are to me, I will be. As sure as seasons are made for change, our lifetimes are made for years, so I will be here, we'll be together, I will be
Welcome to Soul Cafe Radio, where we cater food for the mind and soul. Please join us this hour for uplifting music, messages, and more. And now to the RMG Studios in Miami Gardens, Florida, and the Word Master.
Good morning, good afternoon, good evening. You're tuned into Soul Cafe Radio. I am your host, the Word Master. On today, we begin week one of our Wellness Wednesday series, looking at issues in relationships. And just for clarification purposes, we're talking about marriage relationships. We're not going from before. Today, we're going to seem to start from a foundation that, I mean, we could have pulled back and address the earlier part of what we're going to talk about today, but I thought it was very important that we begin on the foundation of, after we've gotten married and settled into married life, and knowing that we're starting on a fresh foundation such as Adam and Eve had. We'll discuss all of these things as we go through the lesson today. But before we head anywhere, and even before that, I'm going to ask you to please share this podcast with a married couple that you know is going through. And in the description area, there's a link to a study on marriage, actually a webpage that has more information on marriage. It's right there in the description. It says Fortifying the Marriage Covenant. When you search description area, you'll find it. But yes, please share this podcast with as many as you can. Our scripture reading is taken from Ephesians 5, 22 to 27. The Bible says, "Wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands as unto the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, and he is the Savior of the body. Therefore, as the church is subject unto Christ, so let the wives be to their own husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it, that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word, that he might present it to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish." Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your loving kindness and your tender mercies towards us. Thank you for being to us a God like no other. Lord God, we love you and we praise you. And we give you all the praise, honor, and glory that you so richly deserve, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. At this time, we're going to pause to turn to our theme song, which is very fitting for our topic today. It's entitled, Two Sets of Joneses.
You're listening to Soul Cafe Radio, food for the mind and soul.
Please take a few seconds to support the channel. See the info in the description.
This here's a song about two sets of Joneses, Rothschild, Evelyn, Reuben, and Sue. Just for discussion through random selection, we've chosen two couples who haven't a clue. Rothschild was lucky to marry so wealthy, Evelyn bought him a house on the beach. Reuben and Sue, they had nothing but Jesus, and at night they would pray that he cared for them each. And the rain came down, and it blew the four walls down, and the clouds, they rolled away. And one set of Joneses was standing that day. Evelyn's daddy was a proud young Rothschild, worked the late hours to be number one. Just newlyweds, and their marriage got rocky. He's flying to Dallas, she's having a son. What am I trying to say? Well, is your life built on the rock of Christ Jesus or a sandy foundation you've managed to lay? Well, needless to say, Evelyn left her husband and sued him for every penny he had. Those two would find Jesus before things get worse than they already have.
If you remember, as he was concluding the song, he said, so what's the point of this story? What am I trying to say? And notice he said that lives must be built on the rock of Christ Jesus. So we begin our Relationships Wellness Wednesday series by establishing a good foundation, because as any good builder knows, if you establish a good foundation, what comes afterwards is going to be secure, it's going to be sturdy. And it behooves couples to spend as much time as possible establishing that good, that right foundation. And so today, we want to look at this most important topic, naked and not ashamed. Love will be our home. So love is a foundation. And we'll see going forward how this foundation can be laid and should be laid. Remember, Psalms 11:3 says, if the foundations be destroyed, what can the righteous do? So we first meet Adam and Eve in earnest, at least, in Genesis 2. In Genesis 1, we just read the creation account that God made them, and then he said it was good. And then Genesis 2 picks up the story of the creation. So God has all the animals come to Adam, sees them paired up two by two, and then he realized, there's nothing, no one for me. There's nothing that looks like me. There's nothing that walks like me, acts like me, thinks like me. There's nothing that is not under my dominion. There's nothing that's not under my dominion. All of these are under my dominion, so none of them is a suitable companion for me. And brethren, my friends, I want you to realize what Adam experienced that late afternoon on the first Friday of creation. He experienced something that persons have gotten away from here in late 2022, and that is that not everyone or anything is for me. What do I mean? What am I saying? Well, not to get too technical and to put too fine a point on it, but Adam wasn't interested in bestiality. He did not find that suitable. Today, there are persons who do, and to pull back and go other places, you have homosexuality, you have incest, you have polygamy, you have all types of relationship that is not conformed to the principles laid out in the scripture that we're looking at today. And so, after realizing that this is not the ideal relationship for him, and brethren, I do believe that God gave Adam that object lesson so he would understand for himself the choice that was about to be made in his posterity, where it says in Romans 1 that forgetting that principle, the Bible says that man began to sleep with man, women with women. It says it right there in scripture. So Adam was fortified from the get-go, having a good foundation of knowing what constitutes a right marriage. One man, one woman, and we're going to see a key principle in this. Here we go. Verse 21, Genesis 2. And the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon Adam, and he slept. And he took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh instead thereof. 22. And the rib which the Lord God had taken from man made he a woman and brought her unto the man. So, quite literally, woman is the man's rib. And so, how in the world did we get from his support system, his security? Remember, the rib cage protects those vital organs that's encased within, right? So we understand the woman's role of being there for her man. We have gotten away from those high principles. And notice, Bible says, made a woman and brought her unto the man. The reason why I did not go into premarital relationships is because scripture does not condone dating. Scripture does not endorse dating. Scripture doesn't tell us anything about dating. God has one man to one woman, and it's meant to be for life. God forbid that that person or those parties should not grow old and die, as we've seen so many times, moments apart, days apart, etc., and they choose to remarry. Just remember that Keturah and whoever else Abraham may have been attached to, he is forever known to be attached with Sarah. It's Abraham and Sarah. Remember that. That is God's ideal, the life principle. And he brought her unto the man. That is how relationships are supposed to be formed. Again, we're looking at right foundations. Not us going out there on Tinder and E-Date and all what other dating apps there is. Looking. The first place that we need to look is on our knees. And we need to wait upon the Lord to do the bringing. Now Adam speaks. And Adam said, this is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man. That's what woman literally means, of man, from man. Therefore shall a man, see, those are principles. Therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh. Very important principle that brought out in that study guide that I mentioned, which again, if you just joined us, is located in the description area, and the topic says fortifying the marriage covenant. So I would, as an addendum, go throughout that study, which is on the webpage linked there in the description. And once you get to the website, there is a picture of a couple to the right, and you click on that, and you'll have the PDF download, Fortifying the Marriage Covenant study guide. 25. And they were both naked, the man and his wife, and were not ashamed. That last line we're going to focus on, that last scripture. And they were both naked, the man and his wife, and they were not ashamed. Notice that last scripture, and it's a great one indeed. They had not a stitch of clothes, for a cloth for clothes, yet that wasn't their focus. They had the love of the Father and Son through the eternal Spirit, and they had the love of each other, and that was all they needed. Today, because marriages begin with a shower, you know, the bridal shower, the home is usually showered with more things than is needed. but the record states, as the location for a home is sought, let this purpose direct the choice. Be not controlled by the desire for wealth, the dictates of fashion, or the customs of society. Consider what will tend most to simplicity, purity, health, and real worth. And brethren, remember the theme song? Two sets of Joneses? You had Rothschild, right? And he, I guess, coming from that wealthy family, and of course Evelyn also, the foundation was wrong, first of all. Usually in that type of case, they come together because, as you would hear in your Hallmark movies of the type, we fit together, we fit well, we've grown to the next logical conclusion, which is marriage, and so forth. But, my friends, I want you to understand that when God designed the marriage, when God created this covenant of marriage, he did not design it so that it would be so complicated. Case in point, there is much, much that is spent on the wedding. And when it comes to the after, we become so, what's the word they use nowadays? Irreconcilably different, because now we're arguing about expenses. For the wedding, there was no argument about expenses. Nobody was going back and forth because everybody's mindset is, oh, this is the bride's day. And so no expense is spared. Father says, yes, this is my daughter. When I'm giving her away, I'm giving her away gloriously. No expense is spared. But then there comes a day of reckoning when you realize that there are such things as bills to pay, a mortgage to maintain, an overall house and a home that needs an upkeep. And you think back, did I really need that ice fountain? Did I really need a 20-piece orchestra? Oh, that dress. Did I really need to dress like I was the Queen of England? And those thoughts would go through your mind because there's no income coming in as you would desire. Remember the second set of Joneses, right? And Reuben, the ideal husband, hardworking husband, has foresight. My beloved audience, I want you to understand the key phrase that I'll be harping on for the next few moments is right foundation. Notice what the song said. It said, at the birth of his baby, Reuben was clutching a Gideon Bible. So that baby was born on a good foundation. That planning of family was begun on a good foundation. They didn't have much, the song said, but they had each other and they had the Lord, as we're saying in our scripture today. Literally, today, couples come together for financial security. And this obviously most applies to women, but you have some men who they latch on to these, what they call them, cougars, because they have financial security. But it was not so in the beginning. Remember who Adam found himself drawn to. The Bible is clear that he was not going to involve himself with one of the dominion. And so he had to have one with him who would rule as a co-equal with him over that which was their domain. She, beloved, was not part of the domain, so she was not a lesser. They were both equals. Sin, however, marred that plan. Not to say that Eve thought too highly of herself to say, I'm going to be the one who's going to scrub the floor in the Garden of Eden, as it were. And that's what we see in our theme scripture in Ephesians 5:22-27. Love is self-sacrificing all for the other. Love is about the other. Love is seeing beyond the moment and the instant gratifications. Again, one of the reasons why we're not starting on the foundation of dating, because the principle of dating says to, quote-unquote, sow your wild oats and to be involved with as many persons as you can, test to see who you're compatible with. How does that work? And is that working out for a lot of people? And kudos to you. Kudos to you, dear friends. If you found your mate that way or on these dating apps and you have been together for a long time. But it is sad to say, and the saying is true, that many persons have underwear that's older than some marriages that declare themselves to be, that's my soulmate for life. And you know, and you know, and you know, my beloved, if we start off wrong, the rest of the marriage definitely has to be wrong. True love means that we are not ashamed in the simplicity of living. Be not ashamed that you do not have the finest things. Don't look across the fence over to the Joneses' yard. Know that even if you are just getting by on the barest essentials, you are clothed in the unseen but ever presence of God. Be not ashamed. Again, love is the foundation. Love is the walls and the roofs and the furnishings of the home. Love will be our home. There is beauty all around, the song says, when there's love at home. And all those things that we just talked about just now, the obstacles that we have to overcome. If love is the foundation, then obviously, guess what? Love, the Bible says, hides the multitudes of things, and love conquers all. And we know this, but we succumb to so much peer pressure. Oh, the Smith's wedding was so lavish. The Joseph's wedding, man, that was a wedding for the ages. And notice, right, we're talking about weddings. We're talking about weddings. Whoever looks back at a marriage nowadays and says, wow, that was a marriage for the ages. Because so much, you give so much in the wedding. It's like this grand Hollywood production. And yet when it comes to the actual marriage itself, little thought, little attention has been paid to it. So we come into it unprepared. We come into it unrehearsed. We come into it not ready. Why? Forget knowing all the ABCs and XYZs of what marriage life is supposed to be. Forget all that for now. You came into a relationship and you barely knew yourself. You had no clue that when push comes to shove and you have to share the same bed, the same space, literally with another person for the rest of your life, problems are created. I remember vividly an interview question that I asked Sister Novia, who was on a program a little bit ago, and she just beautifully answered it, and it makes sense. And I asked her about, you know, during the COVID crisis, persons have the ideal situation. It's like, you know, the bedroom talks. Honey, we don't spend time enough together. Honey, you're always busy. How come you're always working? And so on. And COVID gave persons opportunity to spend all that time together. And you best believe that many, many broken homes were produced because of this, that they had time to spend together. Interesting, right? Here's the thing, brethren. The emotional trauma, right, that we're looking at today on this Wellness Wednesday. The headaches and the heartaches are because we came into a relationship and we didn't even know ourselves. And so, as we, and you probably heard it, crisis doesn't create character, it reveals it. And so throughout the long quarantine time, she's doing things, he's saying things that were heretofore not even known, not even realized that it was possible. And let's not even whitewash, sugarcoat how even the smallest details produce the greatest grief. The way that the toilet paper is hung, or whether you keep the lid down on the toilet. Think little triggers like that, because now you're in a crisis where all along you wanted companionship and you got it 24/7, but it's not working out. Why? Like I said, because we need to know ourselves first. We need to be at peace with ourselves first, so that when things like this come up, that will be secured, knowing that, oh, I don't major in minors. I don't major in minors. See, going back to one of the things that we talked about that is a heartache and a headache factor is the fact that the bride selects all these things at the registration process. Oh, wow, okay, I could do this. I'm not paying for it. So here's what I want. I want this, I want that, I want the other. And so we have too much things and too little time to enjoy those too much things. Do you realize that? And so we say, oh, I want this, I want that. The eye sees this and the eye sees that. This little tip, my beloved, when it comes to bridal registration, think practical. Not just because someone else is buying. Say to yourself, what could we use very early on in our marriage? What things could we use immediately? Not having to worry about buying it because our friends or loved ones are buying it, but thinking practically, what can we practically use and put that on your registration list? Not just because persons are buying it that you think that, oh, you need a crystal dining set. Again, think practical, think simple. Adam and Eve were naked, but they were not ashamed. Is it that you are competing with the Joneses so much for wedding cred that even marriage cred has to be up to par? That person's coming into your home must see that you're living like kings and queens. That is not the lifestyle of a Christian, my friend. Remember, Ephesians tells us that marriages represent our relationship with God, with Jesus Christ. And Jesus himself tells us this, beloved, that the kingdom of God is not an external situation. It's not external. It's from the heart. And yes, true in fact, that what's in the heart does get manifested out. So too, what's in that home does shine forth. And that's why, again, going back to what was said earlier, marriages do need a good foundation to start off. And like I said, just to highlight some points, let's not marry for money's sake. Let's not marry for security. Let that not be the case. You know, hard, times are hard. You know, let me find Mr. Moneybags or Miss Moneybags and solve that problem real quick. No. That would be demeaning and cheapening God's ideal for marriage. Remember, marriage is a microcosmic experience of what happens in the grand scheme of the universe. And finally, let us close on the theme of contentment. The Bible says in 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 7 through 10, for we brought nothing into six, but godliness with contentment is great gain. For we brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we can carry nothing out. and having food and raiment, food and clothing, let us therewith be content. But they that will be rich fall into temptation and a snare, and into many foolish and hurtful lusts, which drown men in destruction and perdition. Verse 10. For the love of money is the root of all evil, which while some coveted after, they have erred from the faith and pierced themselves through with many sorrows. Harking back to Evelyn and Rothschild. It's because they had it. That's what they keep on going after. And as the song says, having begun marriage on a rocky foundation, not too long after marriage, they were separated. Beloved, a good foundation sets the pace for the rest of the marriage. It's about being ahead, not keeping up with the Joneses. God says, I will make it ahead and not the tail. God never intended for any of us to try to match up with Joneses who, believe you me, are vastly inferior to who you are. Later on today, again, this is being Wednesday, I'm going to be talking to my church family in a morning devotional session, and I'm going to mention that what I just mentioned. You know, other people are going to be one day looking to you and envying you as much as persons who claim to be believers envy persons out there because they have this and the other, and you don't, beloved. I promise you, that having a house naked, not all the trappings of the Joneses, I can 100% guarantee that those things don't make for a happy marriage, a happy life. In fact, they bring a lot of stress because you're going to be up at night wondering when some person is going to come in and try to steal what you've accumulated. But having an old rinky-dink dining table and chipped china, you don't worry about that type of stuff. You can go to sleep at peace. But persons don't think like that. They think that, okay, well, from the get-go, we must have this, we must have that, and we must keep up. Again, like I said, children of God aren't called to keep up. We are called to set the pace. Will you set the pace? I pray by the grace of God that today's Wellness Wednesday episode would have been a blessing to your heart. And couples, I pray for you. I pray that you would truly understand if you have not set that foundation aright and it's fairly early on in your marriage, it's not too late. Not too late to go and dig up and break down. And don't be afraid, don't be ashamed to. You didn't have the right knowledge. That's understandable. The Bible says, at such situation, the Lord winks. Go back and break up. Hire a spiritual jackhammer and just tear up that foundation because it was built on errors. It was built on deception. It was built on lies. Start right and you'll end right. Start right and you'll end right. Remember that. Today is just part one. We have several more weeks to go. We'll conclude at year's end. But I want this to be a pivotal session today because, my beloved, marriage is a serious thing. Some persons have cheapened it and made it not what the God of the universe intended for it to be. But those of us who name the name of Christ and know that his bride, the church, is well loved by him, we understand how well loved marriages are supposed to be, how guarded marriages are supposed to be, and we'll touch on even more pertinent matters as we go through. But for now, join me as we pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your loving kindness and your tender mercies. Thank you for your goodness, mercy, and love. Thank you for being a wonderful, merciful Savior to us. And now, Lord God, as we humbly submit our lives to you, Father, I just want to surrender the couples that are listening to you, Lord God. Father, there are many who started off this walk of marriage on a wrong footing. But you're a God of second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth abundant chances. And so today, Father, I pray that if any person feels the need to go back over the fallow ground and to just dig up and tear up, even though they planted well, Lord, I pray that you will soothe their hearts and let them know that they're doing the absolute rightest thing that they could do for the sake of their marriage. Put, Lord God, help them to put pride away, Lord, and Father, to begin again. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for your words to your people. I pray that persons will see the need to heed these warnings. Bless them, Father. Prosper them. Keep them. Have them secured in you, O Lord God, not in the things of this world. And when time shall be no more, and you ask for the flock, the beautiful flock, I pray that husbands and wives will be together as they present their lovely jewels to you. For Christ we pray. Amen. I want to thank you, my beloved, for joining me today, once again, here on Soul Cafe Radio. As we go off the air, I want to remind you about our description area. There is a link to a website. It's called Fortifying the Marriage Covenant. And on that website, you'll find a study guide. Click on the image to the right and download the study guide, which will give you more information about foundations. May God bless you abundantly. Until next time, take care.
God's family divine, justified fully through Calvary's love. Oh, what a standing is mine! And the transaction so quickly was made, when as a sinner I came. Took up the offer of grace, he did proffer, he saved me, oh, praise his dear name. Heaven came down and glory away, and my night was turned to day.
You're listening to Soul Cafe Radio, food for the mind and soul. Thank you for joining us today on Soul Cafe Radio. You've been listening to powerful music and messages for the mind and soul. Join us next time when we deliver more of, and remember, at www.soulcafe.org.